Project with Chrysler as well. Chrysler built the Chrysler Conquest, Mitsubishi built the Mitsubishi Starion. Even though it sounds like a great idea, Mitsubishi lacked a good bit of imagination by putting a forklift engine inside the Starion. I don't know what they were thinking, nor do you, but that's okay because today we're in my buddy Mikey's Starion. Now, what's different with Mikey's? Well, everything. So essentially, Mikey put a LS1 engine inside the Starion, and it's the LS1 out of the O2 Camaro SS, or Catfish Camaro, F-body, whatever you wanna call it. Now, does it feel like it belongs in this car? Actually, absolutely, when it comes to driving it. Now, when you get to the installation part, no, it does not seem like it fits in here at all. Now, it seems like the Mitsubishi Starion over the Chrysler Conquest has a longer legacy. More people know about the Starion than the Conquest typically because, well, Chrysler Conquest just doesn't sound that cool. The Starion is a solid name, good name brand, sounded cool, and the car looks really good. I love the hatch on the back, I love the side profile, love the classic wheel and tire setup on this car. And also, he did this really amazing race pack gauge cluster in the middle of the dash. And there's a nice carbon fiber piece that surrounds it, which makes it very tasteful. Another thing is the interior feels extremely 80s, but the materials for the time, I am utterly shocked how nice they would have been. This is all soft, this is all nice. There's leather on the dash, or this basically fake leather on the dash as well, but none of it cracks. None of it has the 240SX problems or anything like that of that nature. The cool thing is that he has an aftermarket head unit here. He's got an 8-ball for a shifter, and it feels right at home. And honestly, the bushings on this car have been replaced due to Mikey owns a company that remakes the bushings for the Starion. So Mikey owns a company named MKS Motorsports, and essentially, he remakes the bushings for the Chrysler Conquest and Mitsubishi Starion. Now, are you gonna find them anywhere else? No. Mikey is really into the Starion. He's got a 1G Z1 with 500 horsepower, and he also has this one with the LS1 in it. Now, comparatively speaking, a lot of people are gonna say, oh wow, the LS was the easy way out, the easy swap. Here's the ironic thing. It's the harder one compared to the 1JZ. The LS, you have to do some frame notching. You have to make sure the exhaust gets past the frames. You have to do a whole bunch of really annoying things in order to make the LS1 fit. This LS1 has a cam kit in it and a tune, obviously. It makes 420 wheel horsepower in a Conquest. So, needless to say, it feels right at home. It's extremely notchy to the point that it's kind of confusing. I know that sounds kind of contradictory, but the reverse is not over and down or over and up to the left. It's over and up to the right. So Doofus David was sitting in a parking lot trying to figure out reverse for like 5 minutes, but now it's all good. This actually really does feel very natural due to the bushings being replaced, due to the car essentially being restored. It doesn't feel like an old car that's spinning all over the place. That's what I expected when I drove this car. I expected this car to be spinning really crazy, out of control. Instead, it's a civilized, fun, fast, really oddball car. There's one thing about this Starion that I do want to talk about, and that is this car used to belong to somebody named Tanner. Now, Tanner, unfortunately, had a really tragic accident. He fell down the stairs and hit his head really hard, and unfortunately, he became a paraplegic. Now, Mikey bought the car off of him and then essentially took it under his wing and built this car as a tribute car to Tanner. So that's why when you look at the engine bay, you see these amazing details, right? You see that everything's nice and tucked, very classy. The gold heat wrap, yes, it provides function, but it also looks very nice. But my favorite thing about it is a little plaque right above the intake that's a tribute to Tanner. And that's so, so cool to me that Mikey put all this time and money and effort into this Starion out of all cars. He could have gone out and built something else, but instead, he took the Starion under his wing, he didn't let it go away, and he made a dream come true. Shout out to Mikey for just being super rad, and also, of course, shout out to Tanner. This build has no cut corners, zero. Everything about it is pretty much as good as you're gonna get, if that makes sense, with this car. And also, if you notice too, with the gauges in the middle, you have these little pods on the side that make it feel like a spaceship with these switches, kind of reminiscent of, say, the 300ZX or something, just not as extreme. Suspension-wise, this has D2 suspension. Now, D2 is one of the only people left that makes suspension for the Starion. I mean, this is a very uncommon car. I mean, I don't even see these normally. I never see them just as cars driving around anymore. You never see the Conquest, that's for sure. But when you see a Starion at a car meet, it does stick out because it's different. And it's not another 240, it's not another Supra, it's not any of that. It's a weird JDM / USDM / DSM-ish car that just existed at one point or another. And it was kind of forgotten about. Momo steering wheel. The Momo steering wheel, even though it's modern, it really goes with the interior. I don't know. It, like, this is super modern looking, but everything else kind of goes around it just fine. It doesn't look like it's out of place. Sometimes you see people put really nice, like, wood or gnarly steering wheels in cars that seem kind of out of place. Not this one. This one has this awesome leather wrap Momo. It's perfect. Don't touch it. Has the factory seats, which is pretty insane, and they're 80 seats, you know? They're nothing crazy, they're cloth 80 seats. Kind of something reminiscent in like a Honda Prelude or something of the same era. You had power windows, which was great. You had a digital climate control box, which was not very common, not even today. Today you still get normally the knobs. This had a digital one. But he does have an aftermarket head unit. That's pretty much the only thing that's different from the dash and his gauges. Going back to swapping Starion engines, I met Mikey with his 1JZ Starion at Import Alliance. And he's a good friend of my friend Jesse from Spooled Up TV, who hooked us up with this review. Just want to give a shout out to him. He's a super awesome guy, and go follow his YouTube channel, by the way. But Mikey's 1JZ Starion really stuck out to me with its color and everything. And it even made a special appearance on 1320 at one point, which is kind of nifty. The 1JZ looked like it needed some work to get in there, but in comparison, no, it pretty much dropped in compared to this. This trans tunnel had to be lifted, fabrication had to happen, dedication had to happen. It wasn't a weekend project. This was a very long time, and especially since it was gonna be a tribute, he knew that it had to be perfect. All right, you guys, I hope you all enjoyed the drive of the Mitsubishi Starion. I hope you learned something. I hope you learned about a new car today if you've never heard of the Starion. Very interesting car, very different, definitely ahead of its time internally, but not so much drivetrain wise, I think that's for sure. But what Mikey did was a masterpiece, so definitely gonna appreciate it. And thank you all so much for watching this video. I upload every Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday, and I'll see you guys next time. Goodbye. Go.